We should now thank Frank and ask Ricardo. Barbieri to explain, give us a little bit of his feelings on the present particle physics picture.
Okay. Fai full screen. Non ci riesci.
I don't see it. Controller.
Yes. Okay. Well, so there is no pointer, right? No mechanical pointer. That one doesn't work, so it's all right. You know, the title, you have seen it. Oh, thank you very much. An umbrella, very good. Now the title you know, and I also think you all know what's the status of particle physics after the discovery of the Higgs boson, which after all took place 2 years ago, right? So you have had the time to think it over. So I have decided to take the freedom to add an outlook, right, which is some consideration of how I see the future of the field, okay, in 25 minutes. Now, as you see, everything still goes around the issue of the hierarchy problem. The difference with respect to a few years ago is that now you better add the second question. And if the hierarchy problem were a dead end, we cannot discard that possibility, right? But the hierarchy problem is still around as an important issue. Oh yeah, it came, all right. Now, sorry, all right. Now, around the hierarchy problem, the questions are pretty clear, right? How solid are the current lower bounds on top partner masses? How dramatic is the little hierarchy problem? Any strictly natural theory compatible with current data? That's another question. And finally, can one formulate the hierarchy problem in a conceptually different way? Let me make some comment on each of these questions, right? Now, on the first, I have not much to say, right? We normally quote bounds on top partners of the order of 700, 600 GeV. Well, we have to be careful. We know, for example, the example of the stop, and there are holes that have to be covered, and this is something that has to be taken in mind when we think of the status of the hierarchy problem. Now, how dramatic is the little hierarchy problem? I presume that you know the difference between little hierarchy problem and hierarchy problem. Hierarchy problem is the separation between the Planck scale and the Fermi scale. Little hierarchy problem is the problem that is, you also know, and that is very, you know, pretty clearly formulated there. We know that there are normally correction to the mass of the Higgs. So I introduce delta, which is the ratio between the correction and the mass. And in general, we have a model-dependent coefficient, dimensionless, times the mass of a new physics, whatever it is, divided by the mass of the Higgs squared, right? And the fine-tuning is 1 over delta, the level of cancellation that you need is 1 over delta, and then the behavior with the mass is illustrated there. You see, the best possible value for A is written there, it has to do with the coupling of the top, and is hard to achieve. This, I think, is a typical behavior of some NMSSM, as an example, and this is a typical behavior of an indicative MSSM. And And if we accept that nothing has been seen below 800 GV or 900 GV, this is where we stand with the tuning, right? So this I think you all know. Now, what can be said out of that picture, right? I think two statements. First of all, it's a fact that things do not work the way they were originally thought. We 10 or 15 years ago, we thought that we would have found a scale of physics closer, right, with no tuning. That is not the case. On the other end, in view of the fact that we are after the solution of the hierarchy problem, not the little hierarchy problem, I think that yet this is not a serious problem at the fundamental level. So, you know, there can be tunings of the order of 10% or so in nature. There are tunings at the level of that amount in nature, meaning that the LHC 13 is something that we have to look at very, very carefully and even optimistically. Nevertheless, with what concerns the little hierarchy problem, myself, I have convinced that in any way the FCC-HH is a must. Why? Of course, let us see what the LHC will tell us, but I believe that, you know, even if LHC finds something, which is likely, is possible, right, I am pretty much convinced that that will be only the low energy part of some bigger structure that will have, in order to be understood, will have to be seen at full glory in a higher energy collider. So, I'm careful in accepting the statement that the hierarchy problem is the main motivation for the FCC. I think the main motivation for the FCC is explore the high energy frontier. That is the main motivation. Nevertheless, it's true that the hierarchy problem is an important motivation. C'è un problema? Ah, grazie, grazie, grazie. It is an important motivation, and for the reason that I explained, okay? Now, another question of some interest is the following. Is it possible that we have missed that there is some strictly natural theory compatible with current data that we haven't found yet? Not in my view. If you want, I have shown you in the previous plot. I don't think that there is any theory that we have not understood that is capable to explain the Fermi scale in a fully natural way, without any cancellation. So, if you want, searching for top partners remains the key, right? Stops, composite tops, whatever. That remains the key. However, you know, this is something that, in fact, was discussed already 10 years ago and is receiving some attention now. If one is willing to accept a doubling of the standard model, right, which is something that you may consider to be an epicycle, but if you want to accept that, then it's possible that from the usual picture that we are familiar with, right, in which we expect top partners close by, right, and in fact particles that should be seen, right, should be seen soon if the concept of naturalness is still important. It's possible, if you accept that, that you switch to this other picture in which the top partners, or in any case particles that have normal interactions, SU3-SU2-SU1 interactions, are heavy, and what enters into the game are rather standard model neutral. This M stands for mirror, particles that mirror the standard particles. At the same level of tuning, this is the important thing, right? It's possible that to design a theory in which the particles that that are easy to see, quote unquote, are heavy at the same level of tuning as this picture. Okay, so if you want, this of course is important for the FCC. Yes, it is important for the FCC. should not be considered as non-important for the LHC because there may be chances of seeing this object in some special ways.
Question.
What?
Question.
Please.
I missed one point. Why is searching for top partners a key and not searching for partners of others?
Can you repeat? Can you repeat the question? Excuse me, I did not get
why
it.
Why is the search for the top partner the key and not the search for the partner of other particles? Maybe I missed the point.
Oh, because for two reasons. So the question is why should one focus on searches for top partners? Is that right? And not for other particles. I mean, the reason is that the top partners are supposed to be the key particles in taking care of the hierarchy problem. Point number one, okay? And point number two, it's true, there can be partners of, for example, W's, etc., with no color, and in an hadron collider, to look for colored particles is somewhat easier, right? So these are the two reasons. But the key, if you want theoretical reasons, has to do with the fact that the top partners are the one that play a crucial role in controlling the hierarchy problem. That is the reason, okay? And here on the contrary, you move them up to high energy and you replace them with standard model neutrals, okay, which is a significant fact. Now, fourth question on the hierarchy problem. Can one formulate the hierarchy problem in a conceptually different way, right? I mean, people interrogate themselves on this issue. And I think that the question is valid, right? But for the moment, I don't see anything that works. I don't have the time to discuss that. I don't see anything that works. And I see ways that leaves us in the middle of nowhere. I have in mind, for example, the multiverse, the landscape, things like that. You address the problem in that way, but to me, they don't really lead us anywhere, okay? So this is the first part of the talk. The second part of the talk is what if the hierarchy problem were a dead end? We cannot exclude that, right? And there are more and more people that wonder, rightly so, I think, right? Now, this is the list of subjects, okay? Of course, you understand that I don't have the time to enter into any detail, right? Let me make some comments on each of these of the issues, all right? Now, precision physics, right? Which I think will be an important subject anyhow for the field in the next 10 years or so, right? Now, you see, there are two ways to attack the problem. One, I call it micro-precision, which tries to address the following question. Which possible deviation from the standard model are less constrained, right? Which is the typical question that you ask if you start adding to the standard model higher dimensional operators, whatever, right? And you wonder which are the less constrained. That is a valid question. One should notice, however, that there are many operators that enter into the game, very many, many, and the importance of this approach to me is somewhat limited. There is another point of view, which I call it macro precision, which is more ambitious, but it's more difficult to answer, as always, right? Which is how competitive precision searches are with direct searches of new physics, right? That is the other question. And I try to tell you something in this direction, even though I anticipate that it's not possible to answer in general, right? Now, and of course, there is this competition, which is of interest, right? Precision in scaling versus precision in the electroweak precision test. This is an alternative. So let me show you three plots, okay? First plot, this is a typical composite X picture. So this is a parameter space, never mind the details. This is a parameter space, which at the moment is free, and is characteristic of a composite X picture. And as you see here in yellow, right, with full lines, I have indicated the level of exploration that one might get via these machines, right, typically. All right, I think you can understand, right? as opposed to what you could get with precision at the Z-pole, okay, the delta epsilon I, all right? And as you see, they are very much competitive given these projected sensitivities, right? So in the case of composite ticks, in my mind, the two kind of precision tests are very much competitive. A different situation occurs when I deal with a typically weakly interacting theory. The NMSSM is one example. A special NMSSM, because again, if you look in the full parameter space, you can argue at infinitum. But I consider sparticles, and even the second is doublet here. In the NMSSM, there are two more X's, right? Neutral X's. Decoupled. By decoupled, I mean out of the reach of LHC, not decoupled, not at infinity, but out of the reach of LHC, okay? That is my definition. Which means that you remain with a possible relatively lighter X. To me, you see, this question, this is one of the important questions that we have to answer in the field. Is the X particle that was found the only one? Right, I think that is an important question. And here is an example, right? So here's an example. You see, you can have, in this case, a mixture with the standard doublet of a singlet, right? So this is the object that we have seen, and this is the orthogonal guy that we would like to see. And here I show, in the parameter space, again, the same story. You see the same story, right? These are exclusions by direct searches at present. Direct searches of this fellow at LHC 13 will be done. They are not bread and butter, but they will be done, so there will be some improvement. This is how precision compares. And as you see here, the yellow fellow wins, right? Relative to the blue fellow, right? You see the, you can, I hope you can understand, right? How the comparison is made, right? Given, for example, that delta epsilon I might reach 10 to the minus 4, 10 to the minus 4 is not even here, right? It's here, I think, right? Whereas, on the contrary, the study of the mixing angle, which is a three-level effect, can progress by studying the X coupling, and this is true also in the MSSM. In the MSSM is even clearer, right, the picture. So again, I consider sparticles decoupled in the sense that I said, right, they are not visible at LHC, so I think that their effect, their in loops will be relatively not important. Or I assume that is the case. On the contrary, you might want to look for the extra scalar in the MSSM, which may not be totally trivial to see in direct production. Here is the projection for the X searches, the projection due to in the precision of the X couplings, right? And in fact, LHC14, in my view, might be able to explore all of this plane by indirect measurement of the X coupling versus the delta epsilon I, which again are not that important. So there is this comparison in some particular cases. Yes, I'm not able to make a general discussion. Second issue, which to me seems very important, I call it the flavor paradox. What is the flavor paradox? The flavor paradox is the following. You see, you all know this plot, right, which shows this is not the best plot, I'm sorry, but you all know it, right? Is the correlation, the very, very clear correlation that is emerging between the masses of the particles and their coupling to the Higgs boson, right? You all know that, right? This, to me, is a fantastic achievement, really a fantastic achievement, which shows that the coupling of the Higgs to the particle is a piece of physical reality, right? Now we know that it is a piece of physical reality. Now, that has to be contrasted with the fact that we don't have the slightest idea of what is the rationale for this lambda I, right? So that is the flavored paradox, right? You must agree with me, right? We know that these are real objects, and we have no idea of what gives the pattern. So, to me, that shows that the flavor is very important, and the goal, to me, is that one should make an effort to test CKM, which means to test flavor change in neutral current loops, to test loops from current precision, which is typically 20%, down to 1% or less, which I claim is possible, provided you follow this direction. That is to say, you take seriously the suggestion that it may be possible with proper studies, right, to be able to deal with a number of events, which is typically a factor of 100 or 1,000, factor of 100 larger than what one normally thinks to do, right? Another way to illustrate the same thing is this plot, which I find it very interesting, which is the projection in the quark sector for some key observables, which I don't even define for you, right? So this is the projection that the combination of the various experiment should be able to reach in the future for these key flavor observables. And as you see, there is a clear flattening of the sensitivity, right? After some time that I have taken here a little bit arbitrarily as 2022, right? So there is this sort of stop in the increase in the sensitivity with the current foreseen activity in flavor physics, which I think for the future is something that has to be taken in mind. The situation in the case of leptons is less obvious, right? Because because the standard model has no effect. So you see, in the previous case, we know that at least as an objective, we can test FCNC loops at the level of 1%, right? Now, compare, for example, with the epsilon I's, right? With the electroweak precision test. There, we test loop at the level of 20% now, not more, 20%. I mean, the epsilon I are measured at the level of 10^-4, but those are three level of observables, okay? So we are testing electroweak precision test loops at the level of 20% now, and we might be able to get to few percent with, for example, TLEP, or as you call it now, FCC, EE. Here, I claim that one can test FCNC loops at the level of 1%, and even better. Now, for lepton flavor, the situation is different for reasons that we know, that in the standard model, all of these processes are not there, right? The motivation, of course, is that there may be extra degrees of freedom, right? And, of course, unification, because if there is unification, leptons have to behave in a way which is similar to quarks, and therefore we might expect this phenomena. And, the only comment that I have is that if you look at this table, right, in which one sees the date of the last achievements in the different areas, the conclusion that there is time for improvement. It's time for improvement. One example of astro-cosmo particle connection, which is also, I think, very, very important and should be kept in mind. This, I find it remarkable to the extent that it is a defendable plot, which I think it is. Now, So this is the power spectrum of density perturbation of dark matter, essentially, that you try to get come si dice in italiano, in inglese, lensing, but gravitational lensing, okay? Gravitational lensing. Euclid is the thing, right? So here you have this power density spectrum against the wave number, so 1/megaparsec, okay? 1/megaparsec. So this is short distances and this is large distances, okay? Now, at large distances you are limited by observational error, and short distances you are limited by the fact that you don't know how to make a prediction, because gravity starts become non-linear and so you are limited theoretically. However, so given these errors, this is the effect that is known since long time that you expect from a massive neutrino at the level at which there must be at least one, right? There must be at least one neutrino from what we know from oscillations, weighting more than 0.05 electron volts, okay? And you see that the effect is remarkable, right? The effect is remarkable. This is the distortion that you expect from this flat line, if given the fact that there is a massive neutrino, right? Now, of course, we all know that this picture is not independent on priors and so on and so forth, but I find it very significant. And especially if you think in these terms, which seems to me the really key neutrino measurements for the future, right? You see, there are three ways in which we know one can get a handle on the absolute scale of a neutrino mass, right? There is nothing else, as far as we know. One is the beta decay endpoint, right? Another is the neutrinoless double beta decay, and finally, large-scale structure. That's exactly what I said, which is, in the three cases, you get three different combinations of the masses of the three neutrinos, right? Here, I didn't even dare writing them down because they involve the angles and so on and so forth. And in fact, these, so you have a possible triple correlation, right? And the blue lines is if the hierarchy of the neutrinos is normal. I presume you know what that means. Whereas the red line is the errors if the hierarchy is inverted. So it could be that sigma is the first measurement that comes, right? Sigma could be the first measurement that comes. And if we were able to get the two other measurements to see this triple correlation, I think would really be a dream in neutrino physics. And, we know neutrino physics takes time, right, to improve. We know historically. I think we should look at this plot with patience. Now, the last, if I have, it's okay, three more minutes, 4 minutes. So the last comment I want to make is about dark matter. Now, dark matter is very, very important. We all know, right? But perhaps not everybody knows that we have a good candidate for dark matter since long time, which is hard to catch experimentally. Now, this is a plot, which is supposed to show the blue or green region is excluded, right? This is the mass of the axion. This is the mass of the axion. This is the value of the Hubble constant at inflation. Never mind. The region which are open are this one and this one. And the only regions where, in fact, you get a dark matter axion without adjusting parameters, for example, the value of the initial condition of the initial value of the X of the axion field at inflation, right? So the interesting regions are these ones, in which, because theta I is of order one, essentially, right? Here, theta one is of order one. And as you see, the value For the QCD action, right, the motivated action, the QCD action, the typical value for the masses are 10 to the minus 4, 10 to the minus 3 electron volts. There are other pictures, but the action that is motivated, for action that is motivated, this is the thing. And the, you know, the search for the action that that has been going on since a long, long time, decades, is shown here. And the essence, so here you use this coupling. A is the action field, right? So, and the search that you make is you take a static magnetic field and you look for the action wind, the action in the wind in which we are perhaps immersed, to transform into a photon, okay? That's the way in which people make an experiment. And the short story is that you see the axion mass in microelectron volts, right? The short story is that this area, this range, which I claim is the most interesting range, is not in reach. So this, at the moment, is the excluded area. This is a projection that the most advanced experiment in this area is hoping to gain. And as you see, this region is not within reach. So I am almost at the end. There's been a revival of interest in the coupling of the action to spin, right, this is the Lagrangian, the coupling of the action field to any spin 1/2 particle, and in short, if you take a non-relativistic limit of whatever, you have a coupling of the gradient of the action field to the spin, which is an effective magnetic field. Now, there are... This is my last slide. There are attempts using NMR or EMR experiment, NMR or EMR experiment, to try to get into the relevant region of masses. Now, this is an NMR, this is EMR. The NMR has the problem that it's difficult to get to the 10 to the minus 3, 10 to the minus 4 EV. It's almost impossible unless you do use some trick, which has been proposed here, and perhaps EMR is another possibility, electromagnetic resonance. Okay, just to tell you that. One important candidate for dark matter is still evading the efforts to get it. So the conclusion, well, they are pretty obvious, right? In any way, let me read them, right? In the current pretty confusing state of fundamental physics, I think it's true, it's pretty confusing, right? We don't really know which is the dominant direction. It's both useful and necessary to have a diversified program, and this is the least. It seems to me that all of these areas have to be taken in mind. This is not in contradiction, quite on the contrary, with the statement that I have already made perhaps some time ago, but I repeat it, that quite clearly the exploration of the energy frontier is still the main task of particle physics, and I am absolutely convinced that FCC, either in E or in HH mode, actually in HH mode with the EE as an intermediate step, is the way to go. All right, thank you very much.
The confusion was perfectly clear. Any questions?
Well, I did a good job. Since nobody has questions, I think I did a good job.
I have a question.
Please.
You didn't, excuse me, it's my pet little thingy. So, You didn't mention anything about right-handed neutrinos and seesaw and all that.
Well, what I mentioned about neutrinos is this, right? Excuse me. It's not true that I didn't mention anything about right-handed neutrinos, because I showed this, right? I showed this, yes, this. You see, to know that the seesaw works means showing that MB beta is there, right? That neutrinos double beta decay is there. This is the important thing, okay? And now, challenging, very, very challenging, very, very, very challenging, yes. But to see neutrinos double beta decay would be really a major step forward, right? Because you would show that the seesaw works. You would show that lepton number is violated. What else do you want, right? So that is the key thing.
That's not quite true. You can have a Majorana mass term without having seesaw or sterile neutrinos.
Of course, yes, of course, yes, yes, of course. That's right. But then show me a way to prove that the seesaw works. You see, I mean, you are right. I make a step down. And I claim that to show that lepton number is violated in the neutrino sector would be a very, very important thing.
Right. Yes. Well, I suggest you come tomorrow or maybe Thursday, because somebody will discuss how we can see that there are sterile neutrinos at iron mass.
I will certainly come, and I even think that I know what you will be showing, but that's okay. I will certainly can, yes, I certainly can.
Okay, excuse me for somebody else has their own pet thing. Yes, Todd.
You mentioned lepton flavor violation, and we have seen as a poster that there might be the opportunity to have 10 to 13 Z bosons. That might mean that we could expect 10 to minus 13 as a rate of lepton flavor violation. Would this be competitive or not?
You know, to argue about competition in lepton flavor violation is very, very, very delicate. Very, very, very delicate. I think that one should really think more in terms of in an exploration mode, right, rather than making comparison. Because lepton flavor violation, as I said, is motivated, right, because of unification and because it's motivated. But we don't really have well-founded theory that will tell us that that's the way to go, right? I think one has to be, as I said, in the exploration mode rather than in the comparison mode to see what is. If you have a way to enlarge the parameter space of in an exploration sense, I think, you should go. And 10 to the 14 Z's is an opportunity, yes, yes, yes. But I would not, for example, be able to tell how to compare that with mu to e gamma at 10 to the minus 14. No, that is...
No, it's for Z to tau mu or Z to tau e.
No, I know. But a question that you may ask is, how do you compare that with the fact that we know that mu to e gamma at the level of 10 to the minus 14 does not exist, right? And the answer is very subjective, very subjective, very subjective. It's a fact. Lepton flavor violation is an area in which it's difficult to make quantitative comparison.
So that means that, yes, it would be intrinsic?
Yeah, I think so, yes, I think so, I think so. I think so, yes.
Other questions? If there's no other question, I suggest we thank Ricardo very much. Now we have a coffee break, all right? Okay.